Welcome to TVNZ FC. Well, no Chris Chang or Jack Tame this week. Instead, I'll be running the ship as interim manager. But we do have a special guest as we're joined by current Phoenix and former Newcastle defender Stephen Taylor. As the Knicks look to continue their rise up the table, elsewhere Messi pipped Van Dijk to the Ballon D'Or, and managerial heads have started rolling in the Premier League. Now, joining me is, of course, Stephen Taylor, Jack Mabea and Simon Plum. How are we going, guys?
Very good, mate. Thank you.
Nice to see
Super
you.
Sub.
Yeah.
Well, stepping in, you know, when the managers, you know, get a bit of an injury or they're away, someone's got to step up to the plate, so I'm here doing my best. Anyway, Stephen, a great rise for the Phoenix. You guys up to ninth, back-to-back wins. It must be pretty good at the moment.
Yeah, I think a lot of pressures took off the players, and I think a fantastic performance. You know, topped it off both halves. That's something probably we haven't done all season. We've been probably a one-half side where we performed good in the first half and not in the second half, or vice versa. But fully deserved. I think a lot of criticism the teams took in the last few weeks, and the boys have delivered. I think from the start of the season, playing some good football, but wasn't getting results, and then. After the victory game, we got the draw there and we kicked on, and I think the boys are fantastic. Brisbane and then Adelaide took the game to them, and what a performance.
And of course, you guys are in Eden Park this weekend, a place where you are unbeaten, and possibly with a win, you guys could go up to fourth. So that's, you know, it's a pretty important game this weekend.
It's a massive game. I think I obviously experienced it last year. The crowd was phenomenal. I think on the night of my first experience having that, walking out there, you don't need the manager giving you any pep talk. For me, first and foremost, you've got young lads coming in. They experienced that for the first time, you know, on a big stage, and that's what football's all about, playing in atmospheres like that. And I just hope the fans get along and create the atmosphere that we had last year.
Yeah, it was a record crowd, wasn't it, last year for that Phoenix game?
Well, we were there, weren't we?
We were there, of course, yes. And it was a great atmosphere, as you say. You're looking to get similar numbers again, hopefully, this time around?
Yeah, the good thing about it being in the city, walk around in the cafes and down by the waterfront and speaking to a lot of the fans down there, and they're expecting a good crowd. So it's good to see, obviously, last year, and we'll try and build on that this year.
Simon, considering the change in management and everything, it's been a tough start, but things are steadily improving.
Yeah, definitely. As Stephen alluded to, they've not been playing bad football at all. They've kind of been playing well, but just not getting the rub of the green, really. But I think to weather that storm and come through, it shows a bit of character about this team. It's a team in transition. But as the A-League, as you can see, get a couple of results, string them together, and you'll start rising up the table.
Stephen, you're a Premier League veteran, it has to be said. More than 200 appearances for Newcastle. How have you found all the other places that you've played? I believe you've also played in the States.
Yeah.
Compared to the A-League, has it surprised you at all? What's been your reaction to it?
Not surprised me. I think you can, for a player coming from Europe, you come out here, a lot of people might think, oh, you can take it easy. That's one thing you can't do. I think especially for a defender, you're playing against their marquee players, the best players. And I go in week in, week out, players who are trying to, you know, let's say, oh, Stephen's played at Newcastle, for example. They're trying to destroy us on the pitch. So for me, that's a kind of extra fire in my belly every time I enter that pitch. And I've got to lead by example as well. So for me, I've still got that hunger, the excitement, and yeah, I still got the nerves before the game, and that's what you want. And I think people can take it for granted. You know, I've still got that hunger. 33, I'm still going strong, feeling good. Every day training, I've got great lads around us who fire us up and keep us going every single day.
And obviously taking the captaincy from Andrew Durante as well, obviously a player that gave a massive part of his career to the club and really well respected, is kind of taking the armband, giving you an extra bit of pep as well.
100%. I think coming in from day one, you know, he took me under his wing, and you know, you're never too old to learn. And I think having a guy like Andrew around as well, learn from him how he's done his things, and you know, picking his brains. And even now with the manager, always trying to pick the brains of each people and just try and get better and better. And I ask a lot of questions. I'm always willing to learn on the training pitch, even from when I left school at 16. And you go on the pitch and just non-stop asking questions. The amount of times the experienced players are saying, will you just shut up? That's part and parcel of being a footballer. And you've got to try and find out what makes them as good as what they are. And I think, obviously, with Andrew leaving his legacy at the football club. And, yeah, I think he's been fantastic for the football club. And he's still going strong now.
How have you found, you know, you've become skipper now. There was a change in coach. How was the dressing room? Did you have to draw on your past experiences to sort of help that team along? How's it been, that transition?
For me, as a player and as a character, I've never changed. I've always been the same I am on the pitch, off the pitch. It's just I'm very loud, very hyper kind of guy, and you'll probably speak to the boys. I never shut up, and that's just the way I am as a person. But I just feed off people's body language, the way they are, and making sure everyone's come with a smile on their face. The change room's never dead, and we've got a cracking dressing room, great set of lads. And even the young boys now, they're becoming leaders. You know, we're big on that, the values of the players, what they want to achieve, and never get too high, never get too low is the biggest thing we keep saying. And, you know, we've had some bad results, but don't dwell on that. You know, it's one of the biggest things in football is it's a confidence game. And I think a lot of people can beat themselves up if they dwell on the past and the over. Critical, and they've got the outside noise, and especially the press who I keep getting into a few people. But that's you can't expect you're going to get smoke blown up your backside all the time. You've got to accept the criticism and take it on the chin. Don't go hiding from it, especially early on in the season where we had a few bad results. Don't be expecting the manager to come out and try and get you out of jail. I think, you know, it's a man's game, and you've got to step up to the plate and accept the criticism when it's needed. And obviously the press, don't go slating them, because at the end of the day, you're going to get tongue-in-cheek. They want a bit of a bite back. Do your talking on the pitch, and I think everything else takes care of itself.
Do you think the attitude that you've just described there in the changing room, do you think that's helping you now? Are we seeing the results now on the pitch, do you think?
I think, you know, from Uffy straight from day one, he's just said to us, we're not going to change what we're doing. And I think we proved that when we go after teams. You know, we're everything. I think the Sydney game showed a second half. We were full on. We didn't show any respect. A lot of teams probably show these teams respect. We get at teams, and I think sometimes it's bitters on the backside. But one thing we're doing, we're entertaining, and we're doing exactly what we believe we can do and take the game to teams. And we're playing exciting football. I think that's one thing. We come in day in, day out. It's a good place to be around, and we've got some top characters and a top team, which we believe we can do for the finals football, top six.
There's been a lot of new blood coming to the team, a lot of new imports. Gary Hooper, Ulises Davila has been really impressive. How has it sort of been adjusting them into the team? How have you found that? And you know, they're fantastic players to be playing with, aren't they?
Yeah, fantastic. I think you look at Gary, you know, he's come into the group there. His presence, you know, against Adelaide comes on there. He gives us something different. Something different the A-League hasn't seen before. The old school kind of battling ram, you know, he's physical, hoying them about and stuff. But his first touch, he's got that capability of taking it into him like an Alan Shearer type. You know, the hold-up play was fantastic, runs the channels well. Then you've got David Ball, who's just non-stop, literally. I think he clocked up 13K the other day against Brisbane. People don't see the kind of run he does off the ball. And he opens up the kind of... obviously, Uli to come through and get his goals. And the players this year have stepped up. I think we knew it was going to be... I remember the launch I did for the year league, everyone saying, oh, Wellington up for the wooden spoon again. And that was the fire in my belly last year. So for me this year, speaking to the boys about it, everyone's written us off. There's no pressure on the boys. And I always tell them, listen, it's excitement. You go out there, just play free and express yourselves. And that's what the boys are doing.
Well, there is also a mixture with these foreign players, also young Kiwi players, Kakache, McGowett. That must be good to have those guys along and sort of help their development within New Zealand football as well.
100%. I think for New Zealand football, speaking to you know, Alex Rufer a lot, and he's saying about the young lads who are coming through, you see a pre-season, they don't look out of place. And, you know, they've literally, Libby, he's been he's just been getting better and better. From day one, when I first came in, you know, he's been outstanding. And he's got everything in his locker to be a top player. I think he's a young player now, but he's always wanting to learn, and he's doing the right stuff. He's in the best hands for that. And day in, day out, what I see, he's just getting better and better. And you've got your little young lads, and I don't want to build them up too much, and I'm sure you guys will, but they're delivering the pitch, and it's nice to see.
Bezzy, it must be great to have someone of the likes of Stevens' calibre in the team to help those players develop and just share little parts of, you know, his experiences to help them grow in their career.
Yeah, absolutely. I think, you know, every good team needs a good mix, doesn't it, of experience and excitement coming through and that kind of raw potential. What kind of tips are you giving the guys, Stephen, like when you're out on the training pitch and stuff like that? What, I mean, it sounds like you're very vocal.
For me, you've got to lead from an example. I think once they see you out every day and make sure that they've set the standards high. From day one, when you set your standards high, that's when you get judged. And as a player, you're only as good as your last game. So don't dwell on that. And as I said to you, it's like a roller coaster ride. You've got to enjoy the highs, but never get too low when you've got a bad game. And don't be frightened when you lose the ball a few times. You've got the manager on them all the time, making them a better player. Do your extra work, eating the right stuff, and the sacrifices you've got to do as well. You know, you get your friends on the outside that want to do different things. That's the sacrifices you've got to do. How much do you want it? You know, you do get that one shot. You know, I looked at the A-League last year, where 60% of footballers out of contract. It's that easy. If you have one good year, you get yourself to Europe. I think you look at Sapri now, given the opportunity to go to Bayern Munich. Mm-hmm. If the players don't see that as a platform, then there's a big problem. I think they're in the wrong job.
Yeah, they seem very motivated. It's just maybe the mental approach that you think maybe they need the most sort of help with.
I think that at the moment they're taking the pressure on. I think players have stepped up. They haven't played the A-League, and you know they feel like they've been there for years. They're playing with that much confidence and training every day. They're not shying away, and they believe that they should be there. I remember when I was a young kid, you get asked to train with the first team, and sometimes the first team don't want that because they don't want the standard to drop. You know, it's good to see the young lads stepping up to the plate and getting stuck in, and that's what you want. I love it when someone comes and clatter me and train a young kid. I respect that, and you want that, you know what I mean? As a kid, I love all that. That's what it should be. You shouldn't be shying away, and you shouldn't think, I don't belong there. Mm. Don't just be happy just sticking on the Wellington Phoenix jersey. Mm. You know, you want to be saying, listen, I want to take your top. You know, young centre-half coming through, I want to say, Taylor, I'm going to take your top. Simple as that. And that's how I always had a chip on my shoulder at a very young age. I remember playing in a little five-a-side game in training, and I get whacked in the face, could I? And someone says, are you all right? I said, am I all right? Are you all right? I don't need a baby. As simple as that now. And that's how football is.
All right, we'll take a quick break now. And when we come back, we will have a wrap of the Premier League action and Lionel Messi's sixth Ballon d'Or. Of course, this weekend, Manchester City stumbled 2-2 with Newcastle. Stephen, your old club, did you get a chance to watch the game at all?
I did, yeah. Watched it. Very nervy early on. I think come the last 10 minutes, obviously Newcastle pushing. And that's one thing I think the top teams have always done is struggled at Newcastle. And latter stages of the game when that 12th man, obviously the Newcastle fans are non-stop and pushing for the goal. And it's nice to see not sitting back and getting after them. And Jonjo Shelvey, fantastic set play and a cracking shot by him.
Yeah, I was going to say, I mean, Steve Bruce has had a lot of criticism, hasn't he, from certain members of the fan base there. What's your take on the job that he's doing there at the moment?
It's always going to be difficult. You know, Rafa Benitez, for me, I think he was probably seen as the only one since Bobby Robson, you know, who was that kind of, like, big for the fans. Mm. And then taking over his job is going to be always a difficult ask. And from day one, I think Steve Bruce has been under a lot of criticism. Mm. But he's delivered, I think, in recent weeks, and he's got the team playing some good football. It's nice to see they get the results there.
We can't really talk about Newcastle without mentioning Mike Ashley. I don't know what sort of opinion you have about everything that's happened.
Yeah, obviously it's been up and down with Mike Ashley. We've had some good times, we've had some bad times, and obviously at the moment the supporters are frustrated. They thought they were going to get bought out in the summer. Didn't happen. Mm. But the football moves on and you've got to accept that. You know, there's no point dwelling on it. And that's a problem at Newcastle at the moment is obviously the fans, they want to go places, and it's like the reins are on them at the moment. And it's, it is sad to see because it's a fantastic football club when you go there and experience it. Yeah. You know, the fans just want to see success there.
Simon, that draw puts Manchester City 11 points behind Liverpool. Mm. Surely Liverpool can't ruin this.
Never say never with this side. They do love to bottle it, don't they? It's interesting. I don't think the points difference is insurmountable either for City or Leicester, who are obviously now in second, a bit closer. I think the problem for City is the way they're playing. It's not the points difference. They just look like they're misfiring a little bit, which is quite strange to say when you're talking about Man City, but I think it's becoming increasingly a two-horse race, and I think Leicester will be the ones to push them, but it is firmly in Liverpool's hands now.
Mm, that's the other thing, Jack. I mean, Leicester City, 2-1 win right at the death. They just are quite relentlessly keeping up. I think they're about 8 points, though, behind Liverpool, but they have been impressive.
Yeah, that's right, and they're going to keep going. They're going to keep winning, and that keeps the pressure on Liverpool. And I don't think Liverpool have been that impressive necessarily, not hitting the heights that they can do in recent weeks. And there's a few sort of injury concerns now creeping in, a very busy period of the year for the team as well, going off to Club World Cup, and, you know, they've got Champions League matches, crucial ones to play. So it's going to be a tough month or two. I think by the end of January, maybe start of February, you know, once we're through that busy period, I think maybe that points gap will be quite reduced. But I feel like Liverpool are playing with much more confidence than they have in previous seasons. They seem to expect to win, and they know what to do to win now. They've got a bit of an attitude about them. And I think that's possibly what might get them over the line by the end of the season, and why I don't think concerns about bottling it might creep in.
You can barely shut him up now. Eh? Oh,
goodness gracious. But look, there's also been a sacking of Unai Emery from Arsenal. Mm-hmm. And he's, what, the third manager to be sacked in the space of a few weeks. Stephen, what's that like in a dressing room when you have a manager sacked sort of partway through a season? How do you sort of react and deal with that?
I think obviously it gets toxic. You've got a few players who have been out of favour, and it can cause a bit of a rift in the dressing room. It's a fresh start for a lot of new players, and I think when a new manager comes in, it's a clean slate. Every manager always says that to the players, and yeah, I think it can be, when you're not getting the results, especially if players aren't playing, it can become toxic. It's not a good place to be around. But you kind of feel it as well. You feel it's coming. I think after the defeat, you just think it's a matter of time before the manager's going to get the sack, and there seems to be problems in the dressing room there. You know, so I think it's a frustrating time for Arsenal fans, and I think it was just a matter of time for happening.
In saying that, though, Arsenal Fan TV has been hilarious the past few weeks.
It's the gift that keeps on giving, isn't it? I mean, Stephen mentioned the word toxic. It doesn't get any more toxic than it's like a nuclear fallout, Arsenal Fan TV. But yeah, they're a club in trouble, but I don't think it's a case of simply changing the manager that's going to turn Arsenal around. They've got problems with the squad. The fans are turning against them, which is never good. You're looking at probably a 3 or 4 year transition for this club, which is, it's a real fall from grace, but you know, they've got the infrastructure, they've got the money to turn it around, but don't expect it to happen overnight or with one manager.
Freddie Ljungberg, of course, has come in as interim manager, and he got a bit of slack for not wearing a suit in his debut. What do we think about that?
I think he's probably got bigger fish to fry than sartorial elegance.
Yeah, I think, you know, you either go tracksuit or suit, don't you? Yeah. That's your options. And, you know, I suppose once you go from assistant to full manager, perhaps the suit might be a good kind of statement to the team that you're in charge now. It's business time.
David, what are your thoughts? Should a manager suit up?
Listen, that's just nitpicking, I think. When you look at the team, I always go back to the era where they had the Tony Adams leaders, Patrick Vieira leader, you got Thierry Henry, another leader up there. When you've got your core as a leader, and look at the squad now at Arsenal, when things are going bad, which players are going to be the ones that are going to step up? Because I remember when we played at Highbury, it was a nightmare place to go. And then obviously the players they had, it was all characters, big names, big characters. And it was pure leaders everywhere. I don't see the same kind of players on the pitch now. I think you go to Arsenal, believe you can take points off them. You don't have that fear factor of going to an away game and thinking, this is going to be a tough game today.
Is that something that Arsenal can buy? Do you think they can just go out and buy some big, you know, big characters?
It's going to take years. For me, looking at the squad there, you're going to have to take a lot of players, and the way the money is now in football, it's a big transition. I think it's going to be about 5 years. If you've got to get rid of the players and then all these new players coming in, you know, it becomes silly money, you know, to replace a full team, because at the moment you're going to need it's impact players as well. You look at Mark Overmars and players like Dennis Bergkamp at the time who can win the game, change the game. I don't see many in the team who can go and do that at the moment.
Speaking of leaders, Virgil van Dijk just missed out on the Ballon d'Or. Apparently it was about 7 points separated him from Lionel Messi. What were your thoughts as a defender to see a fellow defender so high up in the ranks?
I think it's fantastic. I think, look at Cannavaro. I think that's the last one that actually, so he was the last one, and everyone always rated him as the best. But look at what Virgil van Dijk's done. Yeah, he's had a fantastic season last year. He's been clinical. I've been, you know, a fortress for them at the back. He's been unbelievable. But since then, you can look at Messi. His record speaks for itself. To do what he does year in, year out, and his stats don't lie. And I think when people actually look at it, you can't really argue against it.
Who'd get your vote?
As a defender, Virgil van Dijk. Well, it's great to see, and I think how well, obviously, Liverpool, the Champions League final, speaking to players back in England a lot about him, they just say he's a freak. To come against a player like that, he's got everything in his locker, makes the game look easy. And I think it would be great for him to get it, to get a defender back on there, but I can see why. Obviously, Messi, he is the GOAT, as everyone says.
Right, he absolutely is indeed. Well, thank you very much for your time, Stephen. That's us for this week. Remember, you can find us on the One News website, Facebook, YouTube, and as a podcast in all the usual places. We will see you back next week.